Good morning, everyone.
Good morning. Buenos dias.
Thank you, Susanna, Roberta. I'm going to make sure they write that haiku, though. I'm going to give them a little homework. Got to hear that one. It's really a sincere honor and pleasure to be with all of you here today. Thank you for welcoming me into your proverbial village, into this wonderful proverbial village, and letting me share my story with you around our proverbial campfire that we've sort of set up these few days. It's a story that I hope will leave you understanding the power of storytelling itself, the ability of storytelling to transcend all kinds of boundaries and to let us connect to our shared humanity, which is what's at the heart of the art that I try to do. It's a story I hope will inspire your lives and your work as educators, a story that I hope will keep urging you to tell your stories, which need to be heard loud and clear more than ever. A story that has to do with the universal question of home and the countless things that that big word calls to mind, right? Home in terms of family, in terms of community, in terms of belonging, cultural identity, racial identity, national identity, etc., etc. A word that is as big as love, home. And it's a story that began for me perhaps before I was even born. As I like to say, I was made in Cuba, assembled in Spain, and imported to the United States, which meant my mother left Cuba 7 months pregnant to Madrid, where I was born, and 45 days later, we emigrated to the United States. I'd like to share with you this recordatorio, or a memento of my birth, for a few reasons that tell that story, and that story of home. For one, that's my newborn photo, and luckily I still have the same hair, thank God. But also that newborn photo was actually my green card photo. So that was the beginning of that story. Also, by the time I was 45 days old, I belonged to three countries. I belonged to Cuba, to Spain, and the United States. And I remember looking at this as a little kid and going, what the hell is the Eiffel Tower and the Swiss Alps doing here? I mean, I thought we were Cuban, and I was born in Spain. What's going on here? So those questions of home, that story of home, was there from the get-go. Adding to that script, we moved to a galaxy very, very far away from New York City, where we first emigrated, known as Miami. And Miami was great. and in Miami, it's the only place my dad could get away with wearing those Speedos. But besides the fact, Miami continued that story in an interesting way, because it was like growing up between two real imagined worlds. One, of course, was the 1950s and 60s, Cuba, 50s and 60s, Cuba, my parents, my grandparents, of the community at large. That island we left, that paradise, that homeland that we were from, that place that I belonged to, but at the same time, I had never been there, wasn't even born there, right? So it was this place that was sort of held a really sort of large part of my imagination. It felt real, but yet at the same time, very imagined. And the other sort of real imagined world that I grew up against was the United States. As Pulitzer Prize winner Liz Balmaceda said once, we love living in Miami because it's so close to the United States and we don't need a passport. So, and what that meant was that in some ways I grew up in Miami was a very, and still is in a way, in some ways, a very undiverse community in the sense that everybody was Cuban. And it was a great place to grow up in that sense. And across the whole socioeconomic spectrum. Right? The butcher was Cuban, the lawyer was Cuban, the mayor was Cuban, the gardener was Cuban. So it was great to be grounded in my culture and my ethnicity. But at the same time, America felt like this other sort of real imagined place that I wasn't quite there yet and that I belonged to. And how I contextualized it, like most kids, was through watching TV shows and TV commercials and the foods and whatnot. And this was sort of the fantasy that I grew up with, right? I have Brady Bunch trauma, and I'm realizing there's a lot of people out there with Brady Bunch trauma, but I finally broke the Brady Bunch grid there. But literally, it was more than a cultural misunderstanding, it was more than some fantasy. I truly believed, in a sense, that that everyone north of the Miami-Dade County line looked like this, lived like this, and was this. And that's what it meant to be an American. And I wasn't sure exactly if I belonged there or if I knew that place. And a lot of my early work and in my poetry focuses on Little Ricky, as I call myself, sort of navigating between these two real imagined worlds. You'll hear that in this first poem, which has to deal with Thanksgiving, which just passed. And it was, I'm gonna read it for a couple reasons. One is that it was actually my very first creative writing assignment in graduate school. We read some Whitman and some Ginsberg and some Frost, and the professor said, write a poem about America. And which is the same assignment actually Obama gave me 20 years later, ironically. But I went home and scratched my head and said, like, what America are all these dead white guys talking about? I don't understand. Like, what is, I mean, really sort of spurred me on that question of where is my place in America, and what is my Cubanidad, and what does it mean to be a Cuban in that sense? So for this poem, you'll need to know a couple things. One is, Cubans never really got Thanksgiving. It's kind of this tradition that we really try, but it just doesn't work. And as my mother calls it, San Giving, as in San Pedro or San Ignacio or something like that. It's a whole different kind of feast day. They put out candles, there's a lot of stuff going on that didn't happen at the original Thanksgiving. And of course, there's my fantasy Brady Bunch Thanksgiving. Isn't that just absolutely horrible and wonderful at the same time? So here's this poem, and you'll need there's a reference here to Kennedy, and I think that this is a reference back to the Bay of Pigs, and I think we all know what that meant for the Cuban community in some ways. And for Cubans, pork is not the other white meat. It's the only meat, okay? So here we go, and the poem is titled America. Although Tia Miriam boasted she discovered at least half a dozen uses for peanut butter, topping for guava shells and syrup, butter substitute for Cuban toast, air conditioner and relaxer, Mama never knew what to make of the monthly 5-pound jars handed out by the immigration department until my friend Jeff mentioned jelly. There was always pork, though. For every birthday and wedding, whole ones on Christmas and New Year's Eve, even on Thanksgiving Day, pork, fried, broiled, or crispy skin roasted, as well as cauldrons of black beans, fried plantain chips, and yuca con mojito. These items required a special visit to Antonio's Mercado on the corner of 8th Street, where men in Guayabera stood in Senate, blaming Kennedy for everything. Ese hijo de puta. The bile of Cuban coffee and cigar residue filling the creases of their wrinkled lips, clinging to one another's lies of lost wealth, ashamed and empty as hollow trees. By 7, I had grown suspicious. We were still here. Overheard conversations about returning to Cuba had grown wistful and less frequent. I spoke English. My parents didn't. We didn't live in a two-story house with a maid or a wood panel station wagon, nor vacation camping in Colorado. None of the girls in my family had hair of gold. None of my brothers or cousins were named Greg, Peter, or Marcia. We weren't the Brady Bunch. And none of the black and white characters on Donna Reed or the Dick Van Dyke Show were named Guadalupe, Lázaro, or Mercedes. Patty Duke's family wasn't like us either. They didn't have pork on Thanksgiving. They ate turkey with cranberry sauce. They didn't have yuca. They had yams, like the dittos of pilgrims I colored in class. So a week before Thanksgiving, I explained to my abuelita about the Indians and the Mayflower, how Lincoln set the slaves free. I explained to my parents about the purple mountain's majesty, one if by land, two if by sea, the cherry tree, the tea party, the amber waves of grain, the masses yearning to be free, liberty and justice for all, until finally they agreed this Thanksgiving we would have turkey, as well as pork. Abuelita prepared the poor fowl as if committing an act of treason, faking her enthusiasm for my sake. Mama set a frozen pumpkin pie in the oven and prepared candied yams following instructions I had to translate for the marshmallow bag. The table was arrayed with gladiolas. The plattered turkey loomed at the center on plastic silver from Woolworths. I uttered a bilingual blessing, and the turkey was passed around like a game of Russian roulette. Dry, Gilberto complained, and proceeded to drown the lean slices with pork fat drippings and cranberry jelly, la mierda roja esa, as he called it. Faces fell when Mama presented her ochre pie. Pumpkin calabaza was a home remedy for ulcers, not a dessert. Tia Maria made 3 rounds of Cuban coffee, then Abuelo and Pepe cleared the living room furniture, put on a Celia Cruz LP, and the entire family began to merengue over the linoleum of our apartment, sweating rum and coffee, until they remembered. It was 1972 and 46 degrees in America. Thank you. Thank you. So that poem was obviously from a child's point of view or a child's voice, but those some issues of home, that question of home, of cultural, national identity, sort of continue to this day to be a part of my work and what I ask of the world. Those questions of where I'm from and where do I belong. And eventually, naturally, this led me to think about my parents and think, well, where is this Cuba that they're from? What is this story that's supposedly mine, right? And that was especially poignant when it comes to my mother, who you see here. My mother left every single family member in Cuba, behind in Cuba, including her 8 brothers and sisters, her parents, every aunt and uncle, every niece and nephew, for the sake of coming to the United States. And we always grew up with we grew up with half a family, literally, and also sort of half a mother emotionally. And I'd always sort of sensed that sense of longing in her, that despair, that sort of, you can imagine being separated from a family that you thought back then that you may never see again. But when the White House called, they actually asked me to write 3 poems, not one. I had to write 3 poems in 3 weeks. I don't know why they made the Cuban do that, but they did. And for the third poem, I turned to my mother's journey, my mother's story as inspiration, in the sense that I realized that her journey is also not just about courage, not just about loss, not just about longing, but also about faith. The faith she must have had in these ideals of a country that she barely knew, the faith, that leap of faith she had to make. And for that reason, my mother is more of an American than I could ever be. And with all the, thank you, exactly. And with all the anti-immigrant rhetoric lately, it just pisses me off. she is the one who should have been reading that poem. Thank you. She is the one who should have been reading that poem for us in Washington that day at the podium. And this is her with me at the inauguration. I have to take my mommy, you know. And one of my favorite photos of her from Cuba. So this poem asks us to step into my mother's emotional shoes and imagine that we all had to sort of get up out of these seats, pack a bag, and leave everything we've known behind. And it's a way of asking, how might we engage with our country differently? How might we fight a little harder for what we have? How might we appreciate what we have also, look at that side too. How might our dynamic and our engagement with our country sort of change if we knew we were about to lose it? Mother country, madre patria. To love a country as if you've lost one. 1968, my mother leaves Cuba for America, a scene I imagine as if standing in her place. 1 foot inside a plane destined for a country she knew only as a name, a color on a map, or glossy photos from drugstore magazines. Her other foot anchored to the platform of her patria, her hand clutched around 1 suitcase, taking only what she needs most. Hand-colored photographs of her family, her wedding veil, the doorknob of her house, a jar of dirt from her backyard, goodbye letters she won't open for years. The sorrowful drone of vengeance, 1 last deep breath of familiar air she'll take with her. 1 last glimpse at all she'd ever known.
The palm trees wave goodbye as she steps onto the plane. The mountains shrink from her eyes as she lifts off into another life to love a country. As if you've lost one. I hear her. Once upon a time, reading picture books over my shoulder at bedtime, both of us learning English, sounding out words as strange as the talking animals and fair-haired princesses in their pages. I taste her first attempts at macaroni and cheese, but with chorizo and peppers. And her shame over Thanksgiving turkeys, always dry, but countered by her perfect pork pernil and garlic yuca. I smell the rain of those mornings huddled as one, under one umbrella, waiting for the bus to wear 10-hour days at the cash register. And at night, the zzz, zzz of her sewing her own blouses and quinceañera dresses for her grown nieces still in Cuba, guessing at their sizes. And the gowns she sell to neighbors to save her rusty white sedan, no hubcaps, no air conditioning, sweating all the way through our first vacation to Florida theme parks to love a country. As if you've lost one. As if it were you on a plane departing from America forever. Clouds closing like curtains on your country. The last scene in which you're a madman scribbling the names of your favorite flowers, trees, and birds you'd never see again. Your address and phone number you'd never use again. The color of your father's eyes and your mother's hair, terrified, terrified you could somehow forget these. To love a country. As if I was my mother last spring, hobbling, insisting I help her climb all the way up to the U.S. Capitol, as if she were here before you today, instead of me, explaining her tears, her cheeks pink as the cherry blossoms coloring the air that day, when she stopped, turned to me, and said, "You know, mijo, I've been thinking, it isn't where you're born that matters. It's where you choose to die. That is your country." Thank you. Cool. So you can guess which of these three activities little gay Ricky liked to do least. And if you can't guess, you're not allowed to teach anymore. That's bottom line, right? But the idea and the story of home for me in terms of my sexuality was that every sort of gay child, every gay teen, every gay at any age really where you haven't come out, that this idea of home, not in a physical place, but in home in terms of safe space, right? That you grew up thinking, you know, to be cliche, somewhere over the rainbow, a place where you'd be able to live your life without shame and fear, that you'd be able to live your life proudly. And the idea of cultural sexuality, that I can't separate who I am in terms of my cultural identity from my sexuality and that story, the idea of cultural sexuality, these two stories sort of come together, merge and diverge and conflict and whatnot. Enter my grandmother, a woman who was as xenophobic as she was homophobic, so that anything that seemed culturally odd to her was also gay, or thrown in the gay bin, right? So, Cub Scouts, gay. Brady Bunch, uber gay. Little House on the Prairie, gay. Fruit Loops, gay. She wasn't quite off on that one. eventually became the rainbow flag. So, anyway, I had very little wiggle room in my childhood. Because if I wasn't acting a man in this way, I was acting sort of culturally odd, which meant also gay. So anyway, this is a poem in my grandmother's voice, kind of a whimsical but also sort of heartbreaking poem, a persona poem, so that. Again, it's in her voice, and I hope you laugh at her and not with her. Oh, queer theory, according to my grandmother. Never drink your soda with a straw. Men don't use straws. Milkshakes, maybe. Stop buying your mother's Avon catalog in the men's underwear and those Sears flyers. I've seen you. Stay out of her Tupperware parties and perfume bottles. Don't let her kiss you. She kisses you much too much. Avoid hugging men, but if you must, pat them real hard on the back, even if it's your father. Must you keep that cat? Don't pet him so much. Why don't you like dogs? Never play house, even if you're the husband. And quit hanging out with that Henry kid. He's too pale. And I don't care what you call them, those E.I. Joes of his are dolls. Don't draw rainbows or flowers or sunsets. I've seen you. Don't draw at all. No coloring books either. Put away your crayons, your Play-Doh, your Legos. Where are your Hot Wheels, your laser gun and handcuffs? Those knives I gave you for Christmas. Never fly a kite or roller skate, but light all the firecrackers you want. Kill all the lizards you can. Cut up worms and feed them to that cat of yours. Don't sit Indian style with your legs crossed. You're no Indio. And stop click-clacking your sandals like a Tropicana chorus girl. And for God's sake, never, ever pee sitting down. I've seen you. Never take a bubble bath or wash your hair with shampoo. Shampoo is for women. So as conditioner, so as a mousse, so as hand lotion. Never file your nails or blow dry your hair. Go to the barber shop with your grandfather. You're not unisex, are you? Stay out of the kitchen. Los hombres don't cook, they eat. Eat anything you want, except deviled eggs, blow pops, croissants, bagels, maybe, cucumber sandwiches, and those petite fours. Don't watch Bewitched or I Dream of Jeannie. Don't stare at the $6 million man. I've seen you. Never dance alone in your room. Donna Summer, Barry Manilow, The Captain, Antonio, Bette Midler, and all musicals forbidden. Posters of kittens, Star Wars, or the Eiffel Tower forbidden. Those fancy books on architecture and art, I threw them in the trash. No, you can't wear cologne or puka shells, and I better not catch you in those clogs. If you grow a ponytail, I'm cutting it off. Okay? What? No, you can't pierce your ear, left or right side. I don't care. You will not look like a goddamn queer. I've seen you, even though I know you are one. So in that story of home and the quest for home, I eventually went to Cuba for the first time in 1994. I was gonna say 47, I'm not that old. 1994, and it was of course an amazing experience to meet that whole family, that sort of side, the whole half of my family, and to connect culturally in that way. But at the same time, it filled in a lot of questions and a lot of blanks, but at the same time, it was only half of me, right? It was only half of that real imagined world. So eventually I got a creative writing professorship and I moved up to America, finally from Miami. I moved up to Connecticut and I thought, oh boy, sleigh rides in the snow, singing jingle bells and a one horse hope and say. I thought, you know, surely everyone still had those pilgrim shoes. By the way, Marc Jacobs makes a pair. They're like $8,000, but anyway, a pilgrim shoe fetish. Me and Martha Stewart doing arts and crafts in Westport. I thought, you know, this is finally, I'm going to America. And of course, that didn't work out. It wasn't quite the America that I envisioned. So I thought I started traveling a lot in that sense, always with that idea and that story of home, that quest for home, and what does it mean, right? And sort of thinking about it more broadly. Well, if it's not this, if these two imaginary worlds are not quite home, where do I belong? Is it Barcelona? Is it Madrid, where I was born? Is it Venice? Is it any number of places? Then I came across this quote by Pascal that sort of changed my direction and my story. He wrote, The sole cause of a man's unhappiness is that he does not know how to stay quietly in his room. And so I thought, what was that room I left? And was this all been a wild goose chase? Where is home? And I decided to move back to Miami, thinking I only belonged in that space between these two really imagined worlds. And of course, that didn't work out either. So this poem sort of speaks to the idea that you can't go back home. Story goes, the background here is I moved back and I took my partner Mark to Marco Island on the west coast of Florida, a place out of my childhood, poor man's vacation, staycation before the word ever really existed. And I hadn't been there in about 20, 30 years, thinking nothing had changed. I just wanted to take my proverbial trip down memory lane. And of course, everything had changed. And I started cussing and ranting, and Mark tells me, you sound just like your mother. And I thought, my mother doesn't cuss that much. But the truth was that I caught myself speaking about Marco Island the way that my parents spoke about Cuba, in the sense of their loss in terms of passage of time and what can never be regained in a way. So Marco Island in a way became my Cuba. But I find that everybody has in some ways a quote unquote Gulf motel of their own, a place out of their childhood, whether that's a motel or an aunt's house or a grandmother's house or a park, some place where we were home, where we felt, where we always look back at this place as some place where we belonged. And it's kind of always sort of a North Star for us in our lives. So I invite you to think about your Gulf motel as I share mine with you. Looking for the Gulf Motel, Marco Island, Florida. There should be nothing here I don't remember. The Gulf Motel with mermaid lampposts and ship's wheel in the lobby should still be rising out of the sand like a cake decoration. My brother and I should still be pretending we don't know our parents, embarrassing us as they roll the luggage cart past the front desk, loaded with our scruffy suitcases, two dozen loaves of Cuban bread, brown bags bulging with enough mangoes to last the entire week, our espresso pot, the pressure cooker, and a pork roast reeking garlic through the marble lobby. All because we can't afford to eat out, mijo. Not even on vacation. Only 2 hours from our home in Miami, but far enough away to be thrilled by the wider sands on the west coast of Florida, where I should still be for the first time watching the sun set instead of rise over the ocean. There should be nothing here I don't remember. My mother should still be in the kitchenette of the Gulf Motel, her daisy sandals from Kmart squeaking across the linoleum, still gorgeous in her teal swimsuit and amber earrings, stirring a pot of arroz con pollo, adding sprinkles of onion powder and dollops of tomato sauce. My father should still be in a terry cloth jacket, smoking, clinking a glass of amber whiskey in the sunset at the Gulf Motel, watching us dive into the pool, two sons he'll never see grow into men who will be proud of him. There should be nothing here I don't remember. My brother and I should still be playing Parcheesi. My father should still be alive, slow dancing with my mother on the sliding glass balcony of the Gulf Motel. No music, only the waves keeping time. A song only their minds hear, 10,000 nights back to their life in Cuba. My mother's face should still be resting against his bare chest, like the moon resting on the sea. And the stars should still be turning around them. There should be nothing here I don't remember. My brother should still be 13, sneaking rum in the bathroom and sculpting naked women from sand. And I should still be 8 years old, dazzled by seashells and how many seconds I can hold my breath underwater. But I'm not. I'm 38, driving up Collier Boulevard, looking for the Gulf Motel, for everything that should still be, but isn't. I want to blame the condos, their shadows for ruining the beach in my past. I want to chase the snowbirds away with their tacky McMansions and yachts. I want to turn the golf courses back into mangroves. I want to find the golf motel exactly as it was and pretend for just a moment that nothing I've lost is lost. So Miami didn't work out, so naturally what do? You move to Maine. See what's at the other end of 95. Maine, at least it has all the same letters. But in any case, this is my life in Maine. By the way, those were all taken at different times, but that's what we do in Maine. We wear plaid. The two goony gay guys wearing plaid, it's so butch, you know. So that's my dog Joy, my partner Mark, me actually writing the inaugural poem at the kitchen table. And that is not me skiing. I live in a ski resort town, and it's not me skiing. Unfortunately, I had some genetic tests done a few years ago, and apparently Cubans have a defective chromosome. It's the ski chromosome. They can't ski. Add it with the gay chromosome, it's a mess. But in any case, I was kind of sort of at peace with the question of home in some ways. Sort of not giving up, but sort of realized, well, maybe I'll never have that sense of home exactly anywhere. I'd be un desterrado, as I say, a man without earth, without dirt. And then Obama called. And those questions of home got thrown up all again into the air, right? There is no final answer about home, and this sort of began a new phase of that story. And really, some of the heart-wrenching questions I had to ask was like, was I an American? I mean, never really sort of coldly had to think about that. Do I love this country? In some ways, I felt I still needed to be little Peter Brady or Marsha Brady. It still felt like, what is my place in America? And it was hard to write that poem because of that, because I had to dig deep and think about what this country means, not just to me, but what it means to us. And so the greatest gift of the inauguration, of writing the poem, reading the poem, and even to this day, the gift that keeps on giving, was not meeting Beyonce, though, hail to the king. Though, that was, of course, a moment I'll never forget. But really, the greatest and lasting gift was that in a way I realized that I was home all along, and that home was in my backyard. That my story as a Latino man, as a gay man, as a man of color, is America. That my mother's story, a woman who grew up in a dirt floor home in Cuba, is America. That the story of every person in this room is America. And that narrative that hasn't always been acknowledged, of course, but was being acknowledged or being advanced, at least in this moment. And I had the distinct honor and pleasure of representing that advancement in that narrative for so many people like me. In light of that, I think what I really wanted the poem to do was to sort of let us all come home together, so to speak. To let us all sit down and have our place at the American table and to break bread together. It's a message that I feel, of course, is more relevant and urgent today than it was almost 4 years ago. And the other sort of important lesson I learned was that America is still a work in progress. And we have to sort of believe that. It's a work in progress, and it's our duty and our responsibility and our right to contribute to that narrative, to keep working on it, to add a sentence, to add a paragraph, to add a chapter, that to keep telling our stories, again, now more than ever, with that same belief and hope and conviction. Because if we lose hope, we've lost everything. Take you back there for a moment, and I'll close on this poem. And so just think where we are right now as a country, and the hope that this poem presents that I hope will continue. In the moment, I feel America standing as one, putting differences aside and taking a deep collective breath. We pay tribute to something far bigger and more important than any one of us, and I truly feel like one of us, one of we, the people, in the echoes of the president's and others' speeches. I embrace America in a way I never had or thought I could, feeling for the first time that I belong, truly belong, to one country. Not an imaginary ideal from TV or a nostalgic Cuba floating in the sea of my parents' memories, but a real, tangible place that is mine, was mine, all along. I turn to my mother and whisper, "Mama, I guess we're finally Americanos." Senator Schumer introduces me and calls me up to the podium. My mother squeezes my shoulder. I stand more confident than I imagined I would or could be, transfixed by the moment that is no longer about me or my poem or my glory, but about our country. Still, I'm surprised when the president and vice president stand up to greet me and shake my hand on the way to the podium. They both whisper something in my ear that I can't make out. With their gracious gestures, speak silently to my heart. Silently, as if saying, "Richard, here is your country. This is your story. Here, your home." I step up to the podium, look out over the crowd, a patchwork quilt of lies, of stories spread across our ground, under our sky, beneath our one sun. I take it all in as I take one deep breath, then another. This is for them. This is for us. This is for all of us, I think to myself, and begin speaking into our wind. Mr. President, Mr. Vice President, America, one today. One sun rose on us today, kindled over our shores, peeking over the Smokies, greeting the faces of the Great Lakes, spreading a simple truth across the Great Plains, then charging over the Rockies. One light, waking up rooftops, under each one, a story, told by our silent gestures moving behind windows. My face, your face, millions of faces in morning's mirrors, each one yawning to life, crescendoing into our day. Pencil yellow school buses, the rhythm of traffic lights, fruit stands, apples, limes, and oranges arrayed like rainbows, begging our praise. Silver trucks heavy with oil or paper, bricks or milk, teeming over highways alongside us, on our way to clean tables, read ledgers, or save lives, to teach geometry or ring up groceries as my mother did for 20 years, so I could write this poem for us today. All of us, as vital as the one light we move through. The same light on blackboards with lessons for the day, equations to solve, history to question, or atoms imagined. The I have a dream, we keep dreaming, or the impossible vocabulary of sorrow that won't explain the empty deaths of 20 children marked absent today and forever. Many prayers. But one light, breathing color into stained glass windows, life into the faces of bronze statues, warmth onto the steps of our museums and park benches, as mothers watch their children slide into the day. One ground, our ground, rooting us to every stalk of corn, every head of wheat sown by sweat and hands, Hands gleaning coal or planting windmills in deserts and hilltops. Hands digging trenches. Hands routing pipes and cables. Hands as worn as my father's, cutting sugarcane so my brother and I could have books and shoes. The dust of our farms and deserts, our cities and plains, mingled by one wind, our breath. Breathe. Hear it through the day's gorgeous din of honking cabs, buses launching down avenues, the symphony of footsteps, guitars, and screeching subways, the unexpected songbird on your clothesline. Hear squeaky playground swings, trains whistling or whispers across cafe tables. Hear the doors we open for each other all day, saying, hello, shalom, buongiorno, howdy, namaste, or buenos dias, in the language my mother taught. In every language, spoken into one wind, carrying our lives without prejudice as these words break from my lips. One sky since the Appalachians and Sierras claimed their majesty and the Mississippi and Colorado worked their way to the sea. Thank the work of our hands, weaving steel into bridges, finishing one more report for the boss on time, stitching another wound or uniform. The first brushstroke on a portrait, or the last floor in the Freedom Tower, jutting into a sky that yields to our resilience. One sky toward which we sometimes lift our eyes, tired from work. Some days guessing at the weather of our lives. Some days giving thanks for a love that loves you back. Sometimes praising a mother who knew how to give, or forgiving a father who couldn't give what you want. Still, we head home. Through the gloss of rain or weight of snow or the plum blush of dusk, but always, always home. Always under one sky, our sky, and always one moon. Like a silent drum tapping on every rooftop and every window of one country, all of us facing the stars and hope, a new constellation waiting for us to map it, waiting for us to name it together.
Thank you so much. Let's give him another round of applause. So it's become tradition. I think I can walk off. It's become tradition.
Good morning, everyone.
Good morning. Buenos dias.
Thank you, Susanna, Roberta. I'm going to make sure they write that haiku, though. I'm going to give them a little homework. Got to hear that one. It's really a sincere honor and pleasure to be with all of you here today. Thank you for welcoming me into your proverbial village, into this wonderful proverbial village, and letting me share my story with you around our proverbial campfire that we've sort of set up these few days. It's a story that I hope will leave you understanding the power of storytelling itself, the ability of storytelling to transcend all kinds of boundaries and to let us connect to our shared humanity, which is what's at the heart of the art that I try to do. It's a story I hope will inspire your lives and your work as educators. A story that I hope will keep urging you to tell your stories, which need to be heard loud and clear, more than ever. A story that has to do with the universal question of home and the countless things that that big word calls to mind, right? Home in terms of family, in terms of community, in terms of belonging, cultural identity, racial identity, national identity, et cetera, et cetera. A word that is as big as love, home. And it's a story that began for me, perhaps before I was even born. As I like to say, I was made in Cuba, assembled in Spain, and imported to the United States, which meant my mother left Cuba 7 months pregnant to Madrid, where I was born. And 45 days later, we emigrated to the United States. I'd like to share with you this recordatorio, or a memento of my birth, for a few reasons that tell that story, and that story of home. For one, that's my newborn photo, and luckily I still have the same hair, thank God. But also that newborn photo was actually my green card photo. So that was the beginning of that story. Also, by the time I was 45 days old, I belonged to three countries. I belonged to Cuba, to Spain, and the United States. And I remember looking at this as a little kid and going, what the hell is the Eiffel Tower and the Swiss Alps doing here? I mean, I thought we were Cuban, and I was born in Spain. What's going on here? So those questions of home, that story of home, was there from the get-go. Adding to that script, we moved to a galaxy very, very far away from New York City, where we first emigrated, known as Miami. And that was from Miami, if I was crazy. And in Miami, well, it's the only place my dad could get away with wearing those Speedos. But besides the fact, Miami continued that story in an interesting way, because it was like growing up between two real imagined worlds. One, of course, was the 1950s and 60s, Cuba, 40s, 50s, and 60s, Cuba, my parents, my grandparents, of the community at large. That island we left, that paradise, that homeland that we were from, that place that I belonged to, but at the same time, I had never been there, wasn't even born there, right? So it was this place that was sort of held a really sort of large part of my imagination. It felt real, but yet at the same time, very imagined. And the other sort of real imagined world that I grew up against was the United States. As Pulitzer Prize winner Liz Balmaceda said once, we love living in Miami because it's so close to the United States and we don't need a passport. So, and what that meant was that in some ways I grew up in Miami was a very, and still is in a way, in some ways, a very undiverse community in the sense that everybody was Cuban. And it was a great place to grow up in that sense, and I mean across the whole socioeconomic spectrum. Right? The butcher was Cuban, the lawyer was Cuban, the mayor was Cuban, the gardener was Cuban. So it was great to be grounded in my culture and my ethnicity, but at the same time, America felt like this other sort of real imagined place that I wasn't quite there yet and that I belonged to. And how I contextualized it, like most kids, was through watching TV shows and TV commercials and the foods and whatnot. And this was sort of the fantasy that I grew up with, right? I have Brady Bunch trauma, and I'm realizing there's a lot of people out there with Brady Bunch trauma, but I finally broke the Brady Bunch grid there. But literally, it was more than a cultural misunderstanding, it was more than some fantasy. I truly believed, in a sense, that everyone north of the Miami-Dade County line looked like this, lived like this, and was this. And that's what it meant to be an American. And I wasn't sure exactly if I belonged there or if I knew that place. And a lot of my early work in my poetry focuses on Little Ricky, as I call myself, sort of navigating between these two real imagined worlds. You'll hear that in this first poem, which has to deal with Thanksgiving, which just passed. And I'm gonna read it for a couple reasons. One is that it was actually my very first creative writing assignment in graduate school. We read
some Whitman and some Ginsberg and some Frost, and the professor said, write a poem about America. And which is the same assignment actually Obama gave me 20 years later, ironically. But I went home and scratched my head and said, like, what America are all these dead white guys talking about? I don't understand. Like, really sort of spurred me on that question of where is my place in America and what is my Cubanidad and what does it mean to be a Cuban in that sense? So for this poem, you'll need to know a couple things. One is Cubans never really got Thanksgiving. It's kind of this tradition that we try, we really try, but it just doesn't work. And as my mother calls it, San Giving, as in San Pedro or San Ignacio, or it's a whole different kind of feast day. They put out candles. There's a lot of stuff going on that didn't happen at the original Thanksgiving. And of course, there's my fantasy Brady Bunch Thanksgiving. Isn't that just absolutely horrible and wonderful at the same time? So here's this poem, and you'll need there's a reference here to Kennedy, and I think that this is a reference back to the Bay of Pigs, and I think we all know what that meant for the Cuban community in some ways. And for Cubans, pork is not the other white meat. It's the only meat, okay? So here we go, and the poem is titled, America. Although Tia Miriam boasted she discovered at least half a dozen uses for peanut butter, topping for guava shells and syrup, butter substitute for Cuban toast, air conditioner and relaxer, Mama never knew what to make of the monthly 5-pound jars handed out by the immigration department until my friend Jeff mentioned jelly. There was always pork, though. For every birthday and wedding, whole ones on Christmas and New Year's Eve, even on Thanksgiving Day, pork, fried, broiled, or crispy skin roasted, as well as cauldrons of black beans, fried plantain chips, and yuca con mojito. These items required a special visit to Antonio's Mercado on the corner of 8th Street, where men in Guayabera stood in Senate, blaming Kennedy for everything. Ese hijo de puta. The bile of Cuban coffee and cigar residue filling the creases of their wrinkled lips, clinging to one another's lies of lost wealth, ashamed and empty as hollow trees. By 7, I had grown suspicious. We were still here. Overheard conversations about returning to Cuba had grown wistful and less frequent. I spoke English. My parents didn't. We didn't live in a two-story house with a maid or a wood panel station wagon, nor vacation camping in Colorado. None of the girls in my family had hair of gold. None of my brothers or cousins were named Greg, Peter, or Marcia. We weren't the Brady Bunch. And none of the black and white characters on Donna Reed or the Dick Van Dyke Show were named Guadalupe, Lázaro, or Mercedes. Patty Duke's family wasn't like us either. They didn't have pork on Thanksgiving. They ate turkey with cranberry sauce. They didn't have yuca, they had yams, like the dittos of pilgrims I colored in class. So a week before Thanksgiving, I explained to my abuelita about the Indians and the Mayflower, how Lincoln set the slaves free. I explained to my parents about the Purple Mountain's majesty, one if by land, two if by sea, the cherry tree, the tea party, the amber waves of grain, the masses yearning to be free, liberty and justice for all, until finally they agreed this Thanksgiving, we would have turkey, as well as pork. Abuelita prepared the poor fowl as if committing an act of treason, faking her enthusiasm for my sake. Mama set a frozen pumpkin pie in the oven and prepared candied yams following instructions I had to translate for the marshmallow bag. The table was arrayed with gladiolas. The platter turkey loomed at the center on plastic silver from Woolworths. I uttered a bilingual blessing, and the turkey was passed around like a game of Russian roulette. Dry, Dioberto complained, and proceeded to drown the lean slices with pork fat drippings and cranberry jelly, la mierda roja esa, as he called it. Faces fell when Mama presented her ochre pie. Pumpkin calabaza was a home remedy for ulcers, not a dessert. Tia Maria made 3 rounds of Cuban coffee, then Abuelo and Pepe cleared the living room furniture, put on a Celia Cruz LP, and the entire family began to merengue over the linoleum of our apartment, sweating rum and coffee, until they remember. It was 1972 and 46 degrees in America. Thank you. Thanks. Thank you. So that poem was obviously from a child's point of view or a child's voice, but those some issues of home, that question of home, of cultural, national identity, sort of continue to this day to be a part of my work and what I ask of the world. Those questions of where I'm from and where do I belong. And eventually, naturally, this led me to think about my parents and think, well, where is this Cuba that they're from? What is this story that's supposedly mine, right? And that was especially poignant when it comes to my mother, who you see here. My mother left every single family member in Cuba, behind in Cuba, including her 8 brothers and sisters, her parents, every aunt and uncle, every niece and nephew, for the sake of coming to the United States. And we always grew up with sort of, we grew up with half a family, literally, and also sort of half a mother emotionally. And I'd always sort of sensed that sense of longing in her, that despair, that sort of, you can imagine being separated from a family that you thought back then that you may never see again. But when the White House called, they actually asked me to write 3 poems, not one. I had to write 3 poems in 3 weeks. I don't know why they made the Cuban do that, but they did. And for the third poem, I turned to my mother's journey, my mother's story as inspiration, in the sense that I realized that her journey is also not just about courage, not just about loss, not just about longing, but also about faith. The faith she must have had in these ideals of a country that she barely knew, the faith, that leap of faith she had to make. And for that reason, my mother is more of an American than I could ever be. And with all the, thank you, exactly. And with all the anti-immigrant rhetoric lately, well, frankly, it just pisses me off. she is the one who should have been reading that poem. Thank you. She is the one who should have been reading that poem for us in Washington that day at the podium. And this is her with me at the inauguration. I had to take my mommy, you know. And one of my favorite photos of her from Cuba. So this poem asks us to step into my mother's emotional shoes and imagine that we all had to sort of get up out of these seats, pack a bag, and leave everything we've known behind. And it's a way of asking, how might we engage with our country differently? How might we fight a little harder for what we have? How might we appreciate what we have also? Look at that side too. How might our dynamic and our engagement with our country sort of change if we knew we were about to lose it? Mother country, madre patria. To love a country as if you've lost one. 1968, my mother leaves Cuba for America, a scene I imagine as if standing in her place. 1 foot inside a plane destined for a country she knew only as a name, a color on a map, or glossy photos from drugstore magazines. Her other foot anchored to the platform of her patria, her hand clutched around 1 suitcase, taking only what she needs most. Hand-colored photographs of her family, her wedding veil, the doorknob of her house, a jar of dirt from her backyard, goodbye letters she won't open for years. The sorrowful drone of vengeance, 1 last deep breath of familiar air she'll take with her. 1 last glimpse at all she'd ever known. The palm trees wave goodbye as she steps onto the plane. The mountains shrink from her eyes as she lifts off into another life to love a country as if you've lost one. I hear her once upon a time reading picture books over my shoulder at bedtime, both of us learning English, sounding out words as strange as the talking animals and fair-haired princesses in their pages. I taste her first attempts at macaroni and cheese, but with chorizo and peppers. and of shame over Thanksgiving turkeys always dry, but countered by her perfect pork pernil and garlic yuca. I smell the rain of those mornings huddled as one under one umbrella, waiting for the bus to her 10-hour days at the cash register. And at night, the zzz, zzz of her sewing her own blouses and quinceañera dresses for her grown nieces still in Cuba, guessing at their sizes. And the gowns to sell to neighbors to save for a rusty white sedan, no hubcaps, no air conditioning, sweating all the way through our first vacation to Florida theme parks to love a country. As if you've lost one. As if it were you on a plane departing from America forever. Clouds closing like curtains on your country, the last scene in which you're a madman scribbling the names of your favorite flowers, trees, and birds you'd never see again. Your address and phone number you'd never use again. The color of your father's eyes and your mother's hair, terrified you could somehow forget these. To love a country. As if I was my mother last spring, hobbling, insisting I help her climb all the way up to the U.S. Capitol, as if she were here before you today, instead of me, explaining her tears, her cheeks pink as the cherry blossoms coloring the air that day, when she stopped, turned to me, and said, "You know, mijo, I've been thinking, it isn't where you're born that matters. It's where you choose to die. That is your country." Thank you. Cool. So you can guess which of these three activities little gay Ricky liked to do least. And if you can't guess, you're not allowed to teach anymore. That's bottom line, right? But the idea and the story of home for me in terms of my sexuality was that every sort of gay child, every gay teen, every gay at any age really where you haven't come out, that this idea of home, not in a physical place, but in home in terms of safe space, right? That you grew up thinking, you know, to be cliche, somewhere over the rainbow, a place where you'd be able to live your life without shame and fear, that you'd be able to live your life proudly. And the idea of cultural sexuality, that I can't separate who I am in terms of my cultural identity from my sexuality and that story, the idea of cultural sexuality, these two stories sort of come together, merge and diverge and conflict and whatnot. Enter my grandmother, a woman who was as xenophobic as she was homophobic, so that anything that seemed culturally odd to her was also gay, or thrown in the gay bin, right? So, Cub Scouts, gay. Brady Bunch, uber gay. Little House on the Prairie, gay. Fruit Loops, gay. She wasn't quite off on that one. eventually became the rainbow flag. So, anyway, I had very little wiggle room in my childhood. If I wasn't acting a man in this way, I was acting sort of culturally odd, which meant also gay. So anyway, this is a poem in my grandmother's voice, kind of a whimsical but also sort of heartbreaking poem, a persona poem, so that. Again, it's in her voice, and I hope you laugh at her and not with her. Called Queer Theory, according to my grandmother. Never drink your soda with a straw. Men don't use straws. Milkshakes, maybe. Stop buying your mother's Avon catalog in the men's underwear and those Sears flyers. I've seen you. Stay out of her Tupperware parties and perfume bottles. Don't let her kiss you. She kisses you much too much. Avoid hugging men, but if you must, pat them real hard on the back. even if it's your father. Must you keep that cat? Don't pet him so much. Why don't you like dogs? Never play house, even if you're the husband. And quit hanging out with that Henry kid. He's too pale. And I don't care what you call them, those E.I. Joes of his are dolls. Don't draw rainbows or flowers or sunsets. I've seen you. Don't draw at all. No coloring books either. Put away your crayons, your Play-Doh, your Legos. Where are your Hot Wheels, your laser gun and handcuffs? Those knives I gave you for Christmas. Never fly a kite or roller skate, but light all the firecrackers you want. Kill all the lizards you can. Cut up worms and feed them to that cat of yours. Don't sit Indian style with your legs crossed. You're no Indio. And stop click-clacking your sandals like a Tropicana chorus girl. And for God's sake, never, ever pee sitting down. I've seen you. Never take a bubble bath or wash your hair with shampoo. Shampoo is for women. So as conditioner, so as a mousse, so as hand lotion. Never file your nails or blow dry your hair. Go to the barber shop with your grandfather. You're not unisex, are you? Stay out of the kitchen. Los hombres don't cook. They eat. Eat anything you want. Except deviled eggs, blow pops, croissants, bagels, maybe, cucumber sandwiches, and those petite fours. Don't watch Bewitched or I Dream of Jeannie. Don't stare at the $6 million man. I've seen you. Never dance alone in your room. Donna Summer, Barry Manilow, The Captain, Antonio, Bette Midler, and all musicals forbidden. Posters of kittens, Star Wars, or the Eiffel Tower forbidden. Those fancy books on architecture and art, I threw them in the trash. No, you can't wear cologne or puka shells, and I better not catch you in those clogs. If you grow a ponytail, I'm cutting it off. Hey, what? No, you can't pierce your ear, left or right side. I don't care. You will not look like a goddamn queer. I've seen you, even though I know you are one. So in that story of home and that quest for home, I eventually went to Cuba for the first time in 1994. I was gonna say 47, I'm not that old. 1994, and it was of course an amazing experience to meet that whole family, that sort of side, whole half of my family, and to connect culturally in that way. But at the same time, it filled in a lot of questions and a lot of blanks, but at the same time, it was only half of me, right? It was only half of that real imagined world. So eventually I got a creative writing professorship, and I moved up to America, finally, from Miami. I moved up to Connecticut, and I thought, oh boy, sleigh rides in the snow, singing jingle bells, and a one-horse hope and say. I thought, you know, surely everyone still had those pilgrim shoes. By the way, Marc Jacobs makes a pair. They're like $8,000, but anyway, pilgrim shoe fetish. Me and Martha Stewart doing arts and crafts in Westport. I thought, you know, this is finally, I'm going to America. And of course, that didn't work out. It wasn't quite the America that I envisioned. So I started traveling a lot in that sense, always with that idea and that story of home, that quest for home, and what does it mean, right? And sort of thinking about it more broadly. Well, if it's not this, if these two imaginary worlds are not quite home, where do I belong? Is it Barcelona? Is it Madrid, where I was born? Is it Venice? Is it, you know, any number of places? Then I came across this quote by Pascal that sort of changed my direction and my story. He wrote, "The sole cause of a man's unhappiness is that he does not know how to stay quietly in his room." And so I thought, what was that room I left? And was this all been a wild goose chase? Where is home? And I decided to move back to Miami, thinking I only belonged in that space between these two really imagined worlds. And of course, that didn't work out either. So this poem sort of speaks to the idea that you can't go back home. Story goes, the background here is I moved back and I took my partner Mark to Marco Island. on the west coast of Florida, a place out of my childhood, poor man's vacation, staycation before the word ever really existed. And I hadn't been there in about 20, 30 years, thinking nothing had changed. I just wanted to take my proverbial trip down memory lane. And of course, everything had changed. And I started cussing and ranting, and Mark tells me, "You sound just like your mother." And I thought, my mother doesn't cuss that much. But the truth was that I caught myself speaking about Marco Island the way that my parents spoke about Cuba, in the sense of their loss in terms of passage of time and what can never be regained, in a way. So Marco Island, in a way, became my Cuba. But I find that everybody has, in some ways, a quote-unquote Gulf motel of their own, a place out of their childhood, whether that's a motel or an aunt's house or a grandmother's house or a park, some place where we were home, where we felt, where we always look back at this place as someplace where we belonged. And it's kind of always sort of a North Star for us in our lives. So I invite you to think about your Gulf motel as I share mine with you. Looking for the Gulf Motel, Marco Island, Florida. There should be nothing here I don't remember. The Gulf Motel with mermaid lampposts and ship's wheel in the lobby should still be rising out of the sand like a cake decoration. My brother and I should still be pretending we don't know our parents, embarrassing us as they roll the luggage cart past the front desk, loaded with our scruffy suitcases, 2 dozen loaves of Cuban bread, brown bags bulging with enough mangoes to last the entire week, our espresso pot, the pressure cooker, and a pork roast reeking garlic through the marble lobby. All because we can't afford to eat out, mijo. Not even on vacation. Only 2 hours from our home in Miami, but far enough away to be thrilled by the wider sands on the west coast of Florida, where I should still be, for the first time, watching the sun set instead of rise over the ocean. There should be nothing here I don't remember. My mother should still be in the kitchenette of the Gulf Motel, her daisy sandals from Kmart squeaking across the linoleum, still gorgeous in her teal swimsuit and amber earrings, stirring a pot of arroz con pollo, adding sprinkles of onion powder and dollops of tomato sauce. My father should still be in a terry cloth jacket, smoking, clinking a glass of amber whiskey in the sunset at the Gulf Motel, watching us dive into the pool, 2 sons you'll never see grow into men who will be proud of him. There should be nothing here I don't remember. My brother and I should still be playing Parcheesi. My father should still be alive, slow dancing with my mother on the sliding glass balcony of the Gulf Motel. No music, only the waves keeping time. A song only their minds hear, 10,000 nights back to their life in Cuba. My mother's face should still be resting against his bare chest, like the moon resting on the sea. And the stars should still be turning around them. There should be nothing here I don't remember. My brother should still be 13, sneaking rum in the bathroom and sculpting naked women from sand. And I should still be 8 years old, dazzled by seashells and how many seconds I can hold my breath underwater. But I'm not. I'm 38, driving up Collier Boulevard, looking for the Gulf Motel, for everything that should still be, but isn't. I want to blame the condos, their shadows, for ruining the beach in my past. I want to chase the snowbirds away with their tacky McMansions and yachts. I want to turn the golf courses back into mangroves. I want to find the Gulf Motel exactly as it was and pretend for just a moment that nothing I've lost is lost.
So know, Miami didn't work out, so naturally, what do? You move to Maine. See what's at the other end of 95, Maine. At least it has some all the same letters. But in any case, this is my life in Maine. By the way, those were all taken at different times, but that's what we do in Maine. We wear plaid. The two goony gay guys wearing plaid, it's so butch, you know. So that's my dog Joy, my partner Mark, me actually writing the inaugural poem at the kitchen table. And that is not me skiing. I live in a ski resort town, and it's not me skiing. Unfortunately, I had some genetic tests done a few years ago, and apparently Cubans have a defective chromosome that it's the ski chromosome. They can't skate. Add it with the gay chromosome, it's a mess. But in any case, I was kind of sort of at peace with the question of home in some ways. Sort of not giving up, but sort of realized, well, maybe I'll never have that sense of home exactly anywhere. I'd be un desterrado, as I say, a man without earth, without dirt. And then Obama called. And those questions of home got thrown up all again into the air, right? There is no final answer about home, and this sort of began a new phase of that story. And really, some of the heart-wrenching questions I had to ask, I was like, was I an American? I mean, never really sort of coldly had to think about that. Do I love this country? In some ways, I felt I still needed to be little Peter Brady or Marsha Brady. It still felt like, what is my place in America? And it was hard to write that poem because of that, because I had to dig deep and think about what this country means, not just to me, but what it means to us. And so the greatest gift of the inauguration, of writing the poem, reading the poem, and even to this day, the gift that keeps on giving, was not meeting Beyonce, though, hail to the king. Though, that was, of course, a moment I'll never forget. But really, the greatest and lasting gift was that, in a way, I realized that I was home all along, and that home was in my backyard. That my story as a Latino man, as a gay man, as a man of color, is America. That my mother's story, a woman who grew up in a dirt floor home in Cuba, is America. That the story of every person in this room is America. And that narrative that hasn't always been acknowledged, of course, but was being acknowledged or being advanced, at least in this moment. And I had the distinct honor and pleasure of representing that advancement in that narrative for so many people like me. In light of that, I think what I really wanted the poem to do was to sort of let us all come home together, so to speak. To let us all sit down and have our place at the American table and to break bread together. It's a message that I feel, of course, is more relevant and urgent today than it was almost 4 years ago. And the other sort of important lesson I learned was that America is still a work in progress. And we have to sort of believe that. It's a work in progress, and it's our duty and our responsibility and our right to contribute to that narrative, to keep working on it, to add a sentence, to add a paragraph, to add a chapter, that to keep telling our stories, again, now more than ever, with that same belief and hope and conviction. Because if we lose hope, we've lost everything. I'll take you back there for a moment, and I'll close on this poem, and so just think where we are right now as a country, and the hope that this poem presents that I hope will continue. In the moment, I feel America standing as one, putting differences aside and taking a deep collective breath. We pay tribute to something far bigger and more important than any one of us. And I truly feel like one of us, one of we, the people, in the echoes of the presidents and others' speeches. I embrace America in a way I never had or thought I could, feeling for the first time that I belong, truly belong, to one country.
Not an imaginary ideal from TV or a nostalgic Cuba floating in the sea of my parents' memories, but a real, tangible place that is mine, was mine, all along. I turn to my mother and whisper, "Mama, I guess we're finally Americanos." Senator Schumer introduces me and calls me up to the podium. My mother squeezes my shoulder. I stand more confident than I imagined I would or could be, transfixed by the moment that is no longer about me or my poem or my glory, but about our country. Still, I'm surprised when the president and vice president stand up to greet me and shake my hand on the way to the podium. They both whisper something in my ear that I can't make out. With their gracious gestures, speak silently to my heart. Silently, as if saying, "Richard, here is your country. This is your story. Here, your home." I step up to the podium, look out over the crowd, a patchwork quilt of lies, of stories spread across our ground, under our sky, beneath our one sun. I take it all in as I take one deep breath, then another. This is for them. This is for us. This is for all of us, I think to myself, and begin speaking into our wind. Mr. President, Mr. Vice President, America, one today. One sun rose on us today, kindled over our shores, peeking over the Smokies, greeting the faces of the Great Lakes, spreading a simple truth across the Great Plains, then charging over the Rockies. One light, waking up rooftops, under each one, a story, told by our silent gestures moving behind windows. My face, your face, millions of faces in morning's mirrors, each one yawning to life, crescendoing into our day. Pencil yellow school buses, the rhythm of traffic lights, fruit stands, apples, limes, and oranges arrayed like rainbows, begging our praise. Silver trucks heavy with oil or paper, bricks or milk, teeming over highways alongside us, on our way to clean tables, read ledgers, or save lives, to teach geometry or ring up groceries, as my mother did for 20 years, so I could write this poem for us today. All of us, as vital as the one light we move through. The same light on blackboards with lessons for the day, equations to solve, history to question, or atoms imagined. The I have a dream, we keep dreaming. Or the impossible vocabulary of sorrow that won't explain the empty deaths of 20 children marked absent today and forever. Many prayers. But one light, breathing color into stained glass windows, life into the faces of bronze statues, warmth into the steps of our museums and park benches, as mothers watch their children slide into the day. One ground, our ground, rooting us to every stalk of corn, every head of wheat sown by sweat and hands. Hands gleaning coal or planting windmills in deserts and hilltops. Hands digging trenches, hands routing pipes and cables, hands as worn as my father's, cutting sugarcane, so my brother and I could have books and shoes. The dust of our farms and deserts, our cities and plains, mingled by one wind, our breath, breathe. Hear it. Through the day's gorgeous din of honking cabs, buses launching down avenues, the symphony of footsteps, guitars, and screeching subways, the unexpected songbird on your clothesline. Here, squeaky playground swings, trains whistling or whispers across cafe tables. Here, the doors we open for each other all day, saying, hello, shalom, buongiorno, howdy, namaste, or buenos dias, in the language my mother taught me, in every language spoken into one wind, carrying our lives without prejudice as these words break from my lips. One sky since the Appalachians and Sierras claimed their majesty, and the Mississippi and Colorado worked their way to the sea. Thank the work of our hands, weaving steel into bridges, finishing one more report for the boss on time, stitching another wound or uniform. The first brushstroke on a portrait, or the last floor in the Freedom Tower, jutting into a sky that yields to our resilience. One sky toward which we sometimes lift our eyes, tired from work. Some days guessing at the weather of our lives. Some days giving thanks for a love that loves you back. Sometimes praising a mother who knew how to give, or forgiving a father who couldn't give what you wanted. Still, we head home. Through the gloss of rain or weight of snow or the plum blush of dusk, but always, always home. Always under one sky, our sky, and always one moon. Like a silent drum tapping on every rooftop and every window of one country. All of us facing the stars and hope. A new constellation waiting for us to map it. Waiting for us to name it together. Thank you.